everybody. Thanks for joining me. Elizabeth Alfano with the Celebrity Dinner Party. I have Jeremiah Tower with me today, so such an enormous treat.
Oh, thank you. Treat for me, too.
So your new movie is out. Executive producer Anthony Bourdain has put together a movie called Jeremiah Tower, The Last Magnificent.
Slightly embarrassing title for me, but a great title.
Suits your bon vivant nature, I would say. It's actually hard to have this interview without a glass of champagne in hand.
Almost impossible.
Almost impossible. Yeah. So we are 11 a.m. here in Los Angeles, which is the only reason that we don't have champagne on a weekday. Otherwise, really, if I interview you, I really should have a drink in hand.
Except 11 o'clock in the morning is the perfect time for a glass of champagne. That's when your palate is the most receptive.
You're
starting to get hungry for lunch, and the best introduction for lunch is a glass of champagne.
Gosh,
and your palate is ready for it by 11 o'clock.
Okay, and your stomach as well?
Absolutely. If you got up at, 6 or 7 o'clock, 11 is when your palate is at its most receptive in the 24 hours.
Oh, I did not know that. Yeah. That's wonderful to know. So for food as well?
Absolutely.
Oh, gosh. Yeah. Okay, so we're going to get lots of tricks of the trade from you before this interview is over. I just want to take people through, if that's okay with you, kind of the arc of the film, and which is really the arc of your life. And then that way we can get into the nitty-gritty once I get everybody up to speed.
Good.
So, again, I would say very much a love letter to you from Anthony Bourdain, really sort of giving you a spotlight in history for those who may not know about you.
Right.
So starting from the very early age, as a young child, you were sort of abandoned, for lack of a better expression, by your parents and left to your own devices. Even though they were around, they sort of had other things on their mind, we'll say.
It's portrayed that way in the film. And, in this day and age, my childhood would look like abuse. It's impossible for people to realize that it was a perfect childhood for me because, I was staying at the greatest hotels in the world, going on the best ships in the world, traveling around the world. A couple of times, I once went around the world by myself when I was 16. So I didn't feel abandoned. I felt privileged. As in the film, they showed me that being served the cup of consommé on the Queen Elizabeth. That was a moment I thought, if this is first class, I never want to give this up. I wasn't abandoned at all. I was living the high lifestyle.
So, yes, you were living at a very young age, even much earlier than 16, you were living the high lifestyle.
Right.
And taking very much to heart the idea of entertaining people and having the best experience possible and sort of over-the-top luxury, if you will. But then we fast forward, we go to Harvard and you're studying architecture.
Right.
And then I'm just giving the big arc for people so they can follow up on your life. So you get out of Harvard at around 30 and you're like, I'm really not sure what to do, but I've always loved cooking. You had discovered food as a child because it was so much fun to be in and out of the kitchens when your parents weren't around on this boat or that plane or that restaurant. And so you sort of stumble into Chez Panisse and you have an incredible career there. At the time, this would have been in the 70s,
right?
It was really a French bistro, Southern French cuisine.
Yeah, Mediterranean bistro.
Absolutely
Exactly.
And you had some historic, I think Anthony Bourdain says now, those menus that you created are historical documents, really, historical
that's nice
importance.
Of Anthony.
But then you sort of, as the chef, you went for a switch and you really wanted to focus on American cuisine, and then we come to know you as the father of American cuisine, the father of French Californian cuisine, and so you leave Chez Panisse and you go on your own to have Stars, which Stars, I will just say, is the first of almost everything in American cuisine. So we have the chef coming out of the kitchen.
Right.
He's there to entertain and to be the center of attention, and you have dining as entertainment, and you have this focus on local food and celebrities and the whole bit. And then you leave Stars and you go into self-imposed exile for about 10 years.
Right.
You come back and you go to Tavern on the Green, and that is a short-lived experience. So with that sort of arc of your life, now I'll get into the real questions.
Okay.
Where did you go and what did you do for almost 15 years of self-imposed exile?
I went to New Orleans. First I went to New York and wrote two books. A company, an Asian company, had bought the Stars Group. And then helped them run for about a year, and then they went on for another year or so. I went to New York, wrote two books, 9/11 happened. I thought, okay, because I lived very close by. I thought, you know, maybe I won't stay here. I went to New Orleans. And then before I unpacked and got settled and everything, I thought, well, I'll just go to Cozumel for a quick dive vacation, pull my head together, and, you know, come back and settle and get organized in New Orleans. And then Katrina hit when I was in Cozumel. So I was suddenly homeless and possessionless. And about 40 margaritas later, I said to myself, well, I mean, if you're going to be homeless, you might as well be on a tropical island. So I didn't look back. And then, you know, 8 months later, Wilma, which was the biggest hurricane ever recorded, decided to vaporize that little tropical island called Cozumel. And so then I moved inland. No earthquakes, no terrorists, no hurricanes.
One would hope.
You know, one would hope.
Yes. Never really sure.
And then so I moved into the Yucatan, because by that time I really was enjoying Mexico and was fascinated by the cuisine in Yucatan. And so I stayed there.
And you are still in Mexico, is that right?
Well, half the time I was in Cozumel diving, and half the time I was writing books in Merida.
And you didn't miss food, working in the food industry, or did you still dabble in some ways? I know you were writing books pertaining to food, but that's different than the artist really touching and working in food.
Which is what Wolfgang Puck says in the movie, you know, where's Jeremiah? I mean, he was born to do this. Well, I mean, after 30 years of shaking 350 hands of plants a day, I needed a balance, you know, so the quiet of a tropical island was perfect.
Yes, it's an interesting, and so many questions for you today, but it's a very interesting thing about your personality. In some ways, you say in the movie that you're a loner, that you're quite, I think you open the movie with saying, I need to stay away from people.
Well, you know, I got so enthusiastic about talking to Lydia and the camera crew and just, you know, saying whatever came to mind and not trying to be careful, that I sent her I downloaded, you know, all the things in my notebooks when I was at Harvard when I was 19 years old, you know, taking mescaline and smoking dope and, you know, living that style in 1962, whatever it was. So I sent her, I gave them to her. I hadn't read them since 1962. She picked up that one, you know, I'm not a human being. And I thought, the movie opens like that. And I just thought, oh my God.
Yeah.
And Lydia turned to me at the premiere of the Tribeca Film Festival and said, are you going to hit me? I said, no, listen, the crowd, the theater is dead silent. It wasn't a peep.
That's
how powerful
me.
That was.
As well. But then you've got this dichotomy where you are a bit of a loner, or you need to stay away from people sometimes. Like, as you say in Cozumel, you took a break. But you've got that bon vivant nature, and that usually means other people.
Oh, yeah.
So it's an odd dichotomy that, excuse me, you need to be around others to celebrate, to create, to make the event the best it can be. And at the same time, you really want to keep your distance. And that's got to be hard to walk that line.
Well, hospitality, I mean, why, if you're going to do it at all, get fully involved. Jump in and swim around in it, you know. But that also means, you know, if you have the energy to do that, you recuperate in a bit of silence, at least for me.
Yes, and I would say that with anything. If you're going to do it, you have to commit 100%.
Absolutely.
And then at the same time, and I find this very true for lots of artists, because I interview a lot of artists, you're so busy creating that sometimes you have to step back and just, for, you know, some people it's 3 weeks in front of the TV and not talking to people,
right,
or
right.
Some people
bad
it's
novels
diving.
Or bad movies.
Yes, right. You really, for as much as you create, you almost need equal balance, letting the creativity come to you, taking it in rather than giving it out.
When I first, after about the first 6 or 8 months at Chez Panisse, I was working 90 hours a week because I would get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, go shopping, come back, cook lunch for 50 people all by myself, and then cook dinner for 100 with one assistant and the dishwasher, of course. And that was 6 days a week, and on this, my day off was doing all the business administration, the menus for the next week. And at one night, I just went, I'm done.
Yeah.
I'm cooked. I mean, I'm cooked. So I went out to Alice, and I said, I'm out of here. See you next week. I went to this little place called Yalapa on the west coast of Mexico.
I love Yalapa.
And there wasn't anyone there. I mean, there were two other guests in this hotel. There was only one hotel. And I went to the bartender in the morning. I said, See that hedge over there? I'll be on the other side of that all day.
Keep the drinks
every
coming.
Every 15 minutes, I want a fresh margarita while I think.
I completely understand. Yalapa is such a little haven.
Yeah.
I was there and I stayed in a sort of an outside hut, and there was no one else. There were maybe seven huts. There was no one else except me and my hut and two anteaters. So I really liked Yalapa a lot. But
so after 2 days of that, you know, I'd had enough margaritas. After 2 days of that, I had my plan for the next few years at Chez Panisse. In that silence, I mean, you get a little sleep, your brain starts to work again, and out of that silence, the ideas start to form.
Yes, and I also think people often forget what a physically demanding job it is to be a chef. So not just the hours, right, and not just how many days a week, but you're constantly on your feet.
Right.
Constantly standing up. It's a very demanding job.
Very.
But then, so you take, here we were talking about a little break to Yalapa, but you also have this long, almost 15 years, I think, self-imposed exile where you're doing some other things and you're writing books, but you're taking a big, long break from cooking.
Right.
You get back into it at Tavern on the Green. Why?
Because I have a fatal attraction for the slim chance, and that was about as slim a chance as it gets.
So it was a challenge for yourself.
Oh, huge challenge, yeah.
But I mean, that's why you chose it, is you wanted that challenge.
Absolutely. As, you know, Proust said, you know, you work and to see if the light is still on.
Mm-hmm.
I want to see if my light was still on, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized it was. I just didn't want to do a big restaurant.
Mm-hmm. Well, so I think of this movie title, and I really encourage everyone to see it because there is so much drama, and the music is so well done, and the filming is so lovely, and so in so many ways, they have done a great job. But I think of this, you say in the beginning of the movie, it's hard, one of the hardest things about life is when you think that maybe your dreams aren't being realized or your dreams aren't coming true.
Right.
And I wonder for you, do you feel that you have set out what you wanted to accomplish? Are there still more dreams to come? Is there a third act in this?
Yes, and of course that comment was also from when I was 19. She was ruthless in using all that material, you know, from... but I think they were perfect in the movie because they are as appropriate for right now, seeing the movie, as then. So that either means I haven't changed that much or, you know, whatever. So I'm always thinking of the next step or the next three, because...
Three ahead.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, it takes that kind of concentration if you want a book published, unless you're, you know, a famous author. So I just got back from Seville, and I saw a property that a friend of mine just bought, 200 acres of olive trees, and a borgo, which is, so it has a 15th century church and a huge factory and a great big house and everything on the top of a little mountain. And I just thought, oh my God. So
is this in the works for a
this
restaurant?
This is in the works. No, restaurant, we're not quite sure. Well, it'll be a retreat or... But, you know, it's. I was fascinated because I met with the mayor and all the people from the agricultural district, and they're all saying, you know, all our olive tree properties are being abandoned because they're so expensive to run.
Mm.
And I said, well, you know, if you, you know, there are ways to find money to run them, and I'll think of them, you know, in the next 6 months.
So it may be an orchard as well as a retreat.
Oh, and a teaching of the, you know, how to bring back the original farming. And so, and I talked to Lydia this morning. I said, Lydia, you have to make a movie about this.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Because it involves the
idea.
Region, Andalusia, it involves the EU, it involves, which is already very much up in the air these days. So I think it could be a great story. It could be books and videos on cooking and techniques and how did they crush olives.
Yeah.
The olive press is 250 years old, you know.
And, of course, many of the best cooking utensils haven't changed. You say an olive press is 200 years old. I mean, some of the best things remain, you know.
And shouldn't.
And shouldn't. Exactly right. And
I
shouldn't.
Always, a modern pestle, you make a garlic mayonnaise, an aioli,
and
a modern pestle. It's light, it has more flavor, it has more perfume, it has a better appearance. And on your body, you don't get that garlic for 24 hours, you know, repeating. If you make it in a machine, there's a certain amount of oxidization occurs, you know, there's heat. So the least violence in winemaking and cooking is the way to go.
And then you're saying you're not wasting the product either, because you're not getting some of its essential juices. And
right, you're getting everything
that you need there.
In the most gentle way. So I'm just dying to get that old press moving again.
So is there a timeline for this that we might be able to look for?
No, I just started. So,
oh, you did.
This year sometime.
Well, let me ask you, we talked a little bit about there being so many firsts for you. So bringing the chef out as star and bringing food as entertainment.
Right.
Forget the play later or the movie later. Now
right.
You've got, dining at stars is
sure.
all the entertainment you need. And then this focus on American cuisine. You are responsible for all of those. And as we look today at Farm to Table, it's directly linked back to you. And yet many people don't know your name. Do you feel that history has done you a disservice?
No, I don't. And, I never thought about that way. People now looking at the story, looking back, you try and reconstruct how it happened. So cooking at Chez Panisse, we're changing, the face of a nation, culinary face of a nation. Did I know? Of course not. I was trying to pay the bills. I was trying
right.
to fill up the restaurant. I didn't. I just knew from my whole childhood and everything that ingredients were where it all starts and where it ends, the green bean story, all of that. So now I've lost track of it.
Yes.
Put us back on track.
You don't feel that history's done you a disservice.
No, absolutely
yes.
not. In fact, if it had, I wouldn't have lost track. No, history isn't, I don't feel that history has done me a disservice. At one point, years ago, Time magazine said that I had more publicity than Meryl Streep. And I just thought, well, true or not, their point is interesting, is that how could a cook become as famous as a movie star, or almost as famous as a movie star? It's just preposterous, right? And that was their point, how a celebrity chef is made.
Yes, and you were sort of the first of the celebrity chefs. I'll
right.
even say sort of chef as sex symbol there for a while, too. So, it was really an exciting time. Chez Panisse for sure, but particularly
right.
stars. And so I'll ask you, because I think it's an assumption that maybe it's not accurate, was there a lot of joy at that time? Was there joy in that? Because, going back to running a restaurant, first we were talking about the difficulties of being a chef,
right.
let alone a chef and a restaurateur. So,
right.
oh my word, the pressure, and it's no wonder you sent yourself away to Mexico and new other places for some time to get away. So was it filled with joy all that time, most of it?
Most of it was joyful because, as you see that thing, that Saturday night at Stars, in the film, when it's like that, everybody's on full high, the staff, the public, the everything. It's an extraordinary feeling when a great restaurant is working very well. It's also challenging when it's not working well to make it wonderful for people, but it's not this, you don't get high from that.
Yes.
You don't get the same kind of joy from it. But I loved those years at Stars. It was all consuming, but that's fine, I like that.
I would think addictive as well, which is why the separation for so long. I'm surprised you didn't get back into the game earlier, that it took you almost 15 years to get back to Tavern on the Green.
I think, all the chefs, like performers, are adrenaline junkies.
Yes,
yes. In the film you see the reenactment of Margot Fonteyn, and then she was quite a good friend. Rudolf Nureyev was a very good friend. And they stayed on way too long.
Uh-huh.
And I saw that. It was quite sad. Rudy died with AIDS, but he tried to dance as long as possible. And Margot kept going back and back and back, and I was thinking, I'd say to Margot, how can I say to this person I really adore, time to go to the beach?
Yes, time to another chapter. Not necessarily a bad one, but Act 3 can be different than Act 2 and
yes,
not be bad.
Yes, exactly. And,
right.
it can be joyful in a different way. But so when I sold Stars, and I had, and I went for 2 weeks to the Georges V in Paris and spending my money and, enjoyed Paris, and I came back and I thought, okay, what next?
Mm-hmm.
So I sat at Zuni Cafe in San Francisco and made a list of what scared me. Did anything, how could anything scare me after the experience of, you know, what I'd just gone through for 30 years?
Yes.
And I thought, well, you know, sharks. Because I grew up in Australia and I had some bad moments in the water with sharks. So I thought, sharks really scare me. So I thought, okay, I'm going to learn to dive with sharks. And that brought my, you know, this obsessive adrenaline glands pumping, you know, 24/7. And so I went and dove with sharks. And so I was able to come down gradually from that without going crazy or becoming an alcoholic.
Tempting, though that might be, with your love of margaritas, and those are my favorite drinks as well. Well, this is interesting to me because you talk about seeking the creative high irrespective of food. Here you're getting it from diving.
Yes.
And, you know, that adrenaline rush. You know, you were introduced to food early on as a kid, discovering in and out of kitchens. Do you think you would have found food as the artistic medium had you not sort of stumbled into Chez Panisse and found food as a child? Do you think in the end you always would have found it, or could you have done anything?
I wonder about that. You know, I mean, stumbling into Chez Panisse is the perfect way to put it, because I was, you know, had down to $25 to my name.
Luck, really, I would say.
Yeah.
I mean.
Yeah, I mean, answering that ad. I mean, well, I was desperate. They were desperate, otherwise they wouldn't have given me the job. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I mean, it helped that I was not a very good architect, or a lousy architect, probably. The only architecture I wanted to do was underwater, and everyone said, that's hallucinogenic. Stop taking drugs. We don't want to hear about that. It didn't come from drugs. It came from, you know, then this burgeoning fascination with the oceans. So I tried that, was broke, and this opportunity came up, so I stumbled into the kitchen, absolutely. So whether I would have found that, I don't know. It's a fascinating question.
Let me ask it in a different way. Are you drawn to food and feel that you must work with it?
Oh, well, less than a week ago, when I stumbled out of my hotel room in Sevilla and I saw this market, I looked through some windows and it was the new central market, and I saw meat and then I saw the fish and I went, oh my God. So I walked in and they weren't really open, but they let me in because they saw me just with my face glued to the window. And I thought, okay, right. I'm going to pop in here right now. I'm going to get a kitchen. I have to cook these perfect, beautiful, wonderful ingredients.
So you are driven. You are driven to food in some way.
Yeah, in some way. Yes. Whenever that connection was made, if I see that pile of perfect baby cuttlefish, mm-hmm. you know, as I did at the market, I just think, okay, where's my pan? Where are my friends?
Yes.
I have to cook lunch for everybody.
Yes. Oh, and that's interesting. Though that's another question I was going to ask you is, do you cook for yourself? Do you get that same joy? Or does the joy really come from cooking for others? So is it making that perfect dish, be it just for you, or
it has to involve people. I mean, I love buying the ingredients. I get a real rush off of that. I love taking them into the kitchen and preparing them and everything. But if I'm just going to cook it for myself, there's something really missing.
Missing, okay. Yeah. So I could have also titled this film The Rise and Fall of Jeremiah Towers. Is there still a third act? And as we've learned today, there is, and it involves olives.
Right.
So with this concept of the rise and fall, I wonder if you could pinpoint your greatest strengths and your strongest weaknesses.
Being stupid is probably, you know, my...
Do you really think you're stupid? No, hold on.
Well, I've made some stupid mistakes, which is all part of it, you know.
Sure.
I forget who it was, but somebody said, you know, your greatness is measured by the chances you take.
I would agree.
And I read that 8 months ago or something. I thought, wow, that's right on, you know, especially after having seen the movie 10 times. But the rise and fall, after I sold Stars... The Examiner did, San Francisco Examiner did, or the Chronicle did a story called that, The Rise and Fall. And I said to the writer who got a James Beard Award for the article, I said, the fall, let's see, but the fall was onto a first class ticket to Paris, 2 weeks at the Georges V, which was the most wonderful, most expensive hotel in the world.
I know the Georges V.
You know it.
Oh, yes, I worked
there. In fact,
there,
the flowers surely. Out here in the lobby are from that guy, that American florist, who set that style internationally. Talking about somebody who changed the world, the face of that. I mean, that one man changed the way hotels do flowers and restaurants do flowers all over the world.
Wow.
The flowers on an angle?
Uh-huh.
He did that. He was the first to do it at the George V.
Isn't that funny? I never would have...
Everything you see out there is exactly his style.
He's referring to the Four Seasons here in Beverly Hills.
Yes,
so,
yeah.
Yes, which is just a beautiful, lovely hotel.
Magnificent, yes. Magnificent.
Old, charming, and yet lovely and gorgeous.
So the rise and fall, I think my strengths are, weaknesses are to make decisions that cause a fall, though it wasn't, it was a fall into, as they say, you know, into the bar at the Chaux Sank in Paris. That's not a bad fall.
That's the fall I would like. Just setting it up for
the future
people.
I was trying to think of the thread count of the sheets, but I couldn't remember. So.
Yes, lovely hotel.
They were probably linen. And so the strengths and weaknesses are, I think, go absolutely hand in hand.
Mm-hmm.
It's taking chances. And my strength is to be able to recover from making a terrible mistake. You know, I mean, Elizabeth Taylor, that famous thing that she used to repeat to people, told me after the earthquake at Stars, she said, honey, when, you know, the going gets rough, when there's a disaster, put on your lipstick, pour yourself a cocktail, and get on with it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't know about the lipstick, but the cocktail and getting on with it, I completely understood. And I think I could not have heard or believe more strongly in that phrase.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think I would agree as well. It's not really so much how much people fail, but what they learn from that and turn it around to go to the next thing.
And get up.
And get up. Because ultimately, I speak for myself here, but I'll say life is about experience more than wins. For me, I like to experience so many things as I possibly can.
Right.
And that registers for me as very joyful, much more so than clocking this win versus that failure. I just don't keep that scorecard.
Brilliantly said, and I realize now that you see it, I don't either. And that's what I mean about taking chances.
Yes.
I mean, success, I tell young cooks, you know, as you're, these opportunities that came to me, I mean, all the things were sort of accidental, but I grabbed onto them. And it's like, you know, horses running by, you can either get out of the way or jump on, you know.
And go for the ride.
And go for the ride.
And it's that zest of life, I think, that comes through in your cooking, really, in the end.
There is
that joy that comes through in the cooking, and that, to me, was really Stars. So I'll ask you, you've been out of it for a while. I mean, you did have that stint at the Tavern on the Green from 2014 to 2015, but you've kind of been out of the real thick of it for a while. What do you think of the food scene today?
I think it's, as you know, incredibly exciting. What all those things that we started back then, not knowing we were starting anything, I have to say, but starting, all that influence, which has gone to, you know, Australia and England and everywhere, is fantastic. And the because I believe it all starts and ends with ingredients, that a great chef finds the great ingredients and then stands behind them, does not grandstand, just prepares them perfectly and simply, you know, and that's the true genius. But what's going on now is that that plate's put in front of you. You could be in Sydney, Hong Kong, Brisbane, Los Angeles, New York, San Francisco, Chicago, anywhere, you know, because the food is all, the plating is all starting to look the same. Not all starting, it has been for a few years. All those little dots.
Yes.
And am I supposed to take my fork and connect all the dots? You know, I use my finger. And then that sort of slide, that sort of smear, you know, and I say, well, it looks like somebody took a cat's ass and dragged it across the plate, you know. I mean,
not appetizing.
Not appetizing. And, you know, what is that carrot puree smear, you know? All those things are great when the first chef does them, when the genius, whether you're in Spain, you know, and you create foam. Actually, when you taste the stuff he did, it was an absolute miracle. It was light and perfumed. So you had wild mushrooms, a teaspoonful of it, but it seemed like you had a whole basket of them. So then, fast forward, you know, a year, and then everybody in the world is doing it, and they've got those little machines, and they think you just, you know, fluff them up and gas them and make foam. No. It was boring, it was stupid, it wasn't right. But the idea, so the inspiration from the first man or woman who did it, that's what is inspiring. But to just imitate it endlessly, thinking that will make you a three-star Michelin or world famous chef, is wrong. And so that's what's going on now.
I'm thrilled to hear you say that, because I actually feel that the food scene is becoming tired.
Boring.
And because I, yes, because I feel that it is so, nothing stands out anymore. There's lots of trying to top each other, but it's not food focused as much as it is presentation, the big marketing push, the new restaurant that comes out, the fanfare, the press machine. And so many of the dishes look the same, and so many of the dishes are the same in terms of what they offer. I'll tell you, this maybe is not going to resonate with you, but I'll tell you something that's very exciting for me is veganism, and to see how people are pushing themselves towards being creative there and doing some really interesting things.
Brilliant.
So I'm very excited about that.
Well, I mean, the wonderful restaurant in Paris called La Pêche, which I think, 20 years ago, or a little less, he said, he was three-star Michelin, and he said, I'm going to become a vegetarian restaurant. And the whole cooking world went, what? Are you nuts? So I, of course, had to go see. And
I have not eaten there. And I used to live in Paris. So yes.
It's La Pêche. It's over by the Rodin Museum.
Okay. One of my favorite museums.
So I looked at this and I thought, you know, because I had always done that vegetable ragu that Richard Olney, the American writer who lived in France, Simple French Food, a book that all cooks should read, he taught me how to make this wonderful vegetable stew, and that got me really excited about a vegetable dish, you know, just water and vegetables and salt and pepper and olive oil. So he had on the menu truffle soup, and I thought, oh, is that Bocuse thing with pastry and, you know, foie gras? No, I don't want that. And the chef came out and said, that's what you're having. And I said, well, for a 50-euro supplement? I'm not so sure. He said, Jeremiah, it's on me. And out came this big white flat soup plate, and filled up to the inner brim was a color, a puree. It was a color sort of Paris in the winter as a storm approaching. So, you know, that dove gray.
Beautiful.
Dark, a little darker than that. And it was a puree of black truffles and cream. And I just about passed out.
Yeah.
So, vegetarian, now vegan, that because it had cream in it.
Right, yeah.
But you get the point.
I do.
That was maybe the best dish I've ever had in my life. And it was simple.
So since we're on this conversation and you are indulging me, I'll take it one step further. I'm very tired of seeing bacon in everything. To me, it just says, I don't know how to cook. Therefore, I'm going to put bacon in the ice cream, bacon in the chocolate, bacon in the whiskey, bacon in the pancakes, bacon in the donut.
And then they put kale in everything after that.
As well. I'm really tired of kale, too. Yes. Okay, people, we are demanding more from you. We are so limited on time here because I know you have many interviews today. So now I have just a bunch of quick questions that I want from you. Okay. Favorite chef. Who's your favorite chef now and today? In Chicago, in L.A., around the world?
Off the top of my head, I'd say the Ledbury in London.
Okay.
Because he's got that. He doesn't do the dots and smears and everything. That's my favorite restaurant.
Wonderful. And we touched on this a little bit before. So you're saying that if you're cooking for yourself, there's sort of something missing. But do you cook for yourself? Do you have a go-to dish that you just always make on the fly that's super easy?
Yes, I love frittatas.
Oh, okay.
Because I take all the leftovers. I love to cook with leftovers. I think that's so intriguing because you don't know what you're going to do until you open the refrigerator door. It's like going to the market. You don't know what you're going to cook. You're going to cook whatever is in the market. So that's your refrigerator, is your market. And so I think a little bit of this, a little bit of this, you know. And they're so easy to do. And they taste better if they've been sitting for an hour. And you can accept eggs and vegetables and olive oil. And fresh herbs. I mean, hello.
I love this too, because I love the challenge of, I don't want anything to go to waste. I just can't help it. It's how I was raised.
Right.
I just can't throw it out.
Right.
And so here I'm given this challenge, and there in Life's of Creativity is I have to use what's in my fridge.
Right.
And that's always fun.
Or you can
for
make
me.
Soup out of it as well.
So what's the one dish that everyone should know how to make?
Everyone should know how to make scrambled eggs the French style, so that they're not dry and tough and everything, because that's so easy. You put that on, you know, a slice of bread. Of course, I'm not going to say you have to have black truffles to put in them, but if you do, I think everyone should know how to make a vegetable soup, because you know, if you're working as a writer all night, you know, you can have vegetable soup for breakfast. For me, again, it's emptying the refrigerator, but one of the greatest dishes I ever had was coming after a long lunch in the south of France with Richard Olney, who I talked about before, and there was nothing around, so he pulled out of the garden potatoes and leeks. So we had water, potatoes, leeks, cooked together, salt, and at the end of the table, a little olive oil on top, and it was just fabulous. Much more fabulous than if it had been with chicken stock. It was just that purity of the vegetables. So I think everyone should know how to make something like that.
And simple is always better.
Simple is always better, yeah.
So what if we were to go into your home right now, what would be in your fridge? What are you always going to have in your fridge?
It's much, much more what's in the freezer that's interesting.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Vodka, Häagen-Dazs, dulce de leche ice cream.
So you've answered my next question, which is, what's your favorite snack? Is it ice
cream? And favorite snack, no, would probably be perfect tomatoes on a saltine with Hellmann's mayonnaise and salt and pepper on top of the tomato.
Like Hellmann's mayonnaise.
Because Hellmann's mayonnaise, I cannot stand the taste of it, mayonnaise that I haven't, you know, made myself except for Hellmann's. Because
really?
It's a whole different thing. Oh. It's not really mayonnaise.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, because my aunt taught me to make, in my books, and my aunt's coleslaw, and she uses Hellmann mayonnaise, and I've tried it with making with real mayonnaise, not nearly as interesting.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. I've recently gone vegan, so I maybe won't consider Hellmann's mayonnaise, but I'll have my boyfriend
there you
take,
go.
A, take a
there
pass
you go.
At Hellmann's mayonnaise.
So don't use, just put olive oil on the cracker,
yes,
and put the tomato. Or sardines, great sardines on toast.
Yes, I find with tomatoes, just even straight olives.
Straight olives,
just olives and tomato, little salad, and then on a cracker.
Yeah,
fantastic.
Perfect.
So very last question, and maybe you saw this coming. You're on a show called The Celebrity Dinner Party. So
right.
Who would you like to have dinner with?
Ah, and cook for, you mean? Or have dinner with, that's different.
Let's do let's bifurcate the question.
Okay.
Who would you like to cook for, and who would you like to sit down and have dinner with?
Let's see. I would love to have sat down and have dinner with Lucius Beebe, not the last Magnificent. I loved cooking for Margot Fonteyn and Rudy together in my student apartment in Somerville in Cambridge, Mass. Really student apartment. And there she turned up in a white mink, you know, and black Armani. And, you know, and of course this was a, you know, $50 a month apartment. And she just dug into, you know, the roast beef and everything. Moments like that. So is there anyone around now? I'd love to have dinner with Tony Burdan, Anthony Burdan.
Yes. Oh, yes, sure. He would be fascinating, of course.
He's so intelligent and articulate and a great guy.
Yeah, and seems to be a warm-natured person.
He is. Yes. He is, yeah.
Well, just one tiny more question now that I've got you, because you're making me think of this. Do you entertain at home? I mean, here you used to entertain so many at Stars. Do you have dinner parties at home?
Yes, I do.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. And 6, 8, 10, 12?
Oh, no, I mean 6.
6. Six, so really intimate dinner
six
parties.
6 is good, yeah.
There's nothing better.
I've done
home.
The, you know, the 500 parties. I just cooked dinner for 300 people at Oxford University in one of the colleges for the Financial Times Festival. It was a huge success, which I didn't know whether it was going to be or not. So that was fun. But I don't think I'll do that anymore.
Yeah. Well, I always feel like there's no better way to connect with people than to cook for them in your home in
Absolutely.
A small, intimate group, and it's going to forge a friendship that will last forever.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more.
Jeremiah, thanks for speaking
with
me today.
Thank you. It's been a great pleasure.